have the first session of questions for you. Thank you very much, Reverend Knight, for your understanding. The session for you will be after this first session for Professor Gagnon. So please, questions.
I will try to be the first who for you the resemblance, meaning the development of iconic ontological humankind after the creation of God, it's the big project. What is the significance of mystical experience regarding this resemblance with God?
Yes, this is at the heart of what I have in mind to be, because I mentioned the word that creates the image, the spirit creates in the resemblance. If you are a purist and you go read the Hebrew text, which I did, you find image being repeated. So it is really an hermeneutic question why we consider that there is this given and this to come, right? This challenge to become and to do it in faithfulness to God. And I think that, as you suggested, if I understood well your question, if the image cannot be lost, the resemblance becomes the great project. Now, the question that I sneaked in and that you noticed is that if you were to get man out of his humanness, in other words, if you were to say that, you know, to think alongside the lines of Athanasius, for instance, that, you know, we're image of the image, there's really one image, it's Christ, and so then the identification with our humanity, the philanthropy of God, the fact of taking everything, and St. Paul will say he made sin, although he didn't sin, he took a flesh that's marked by sin. And so the fact of assuming all of this, if you retreat and walk away from it, and if you look at hybridization between man and animal, and if you make our nature only an animalistic nature, at what point, or is there a line and cut out at which you'd be out of this stability of the image? That's the question I was trying to raise. And I think that indeed the mystical life is, and I would again call unto Irenaeus for powerful resources, but the image concerns the body. There is a, I can remember a text of Jacques Maritain talks about the never appreciated beauty of our bodies, and the fact that they are, you know, cosmic dust. All of this calls for not only a mystical, as you suggested, engagement, but a whole anthropology. And I think that in the dialogue with transhumanists, one would have to try to put his finger, which is what I attempted here, but very little time, it's merely introductory, put his finger on where this has diverged, because you have a very Platonic, mathematical, resolving itself in itself kind of model, and at the same time, what you have in contemporary computationalist paradigm that I talked about is recognition that there are gestalt elements, that there are embodied elements in the decisions we make that are purely on the side of intuition, and that powerful calculational energy, so to speak, of machines will never achieve. And so there is also a limit set on what programs can do by looking at the human. Would that be a way to reintroduce the question of the embodiment? I think it is, and I think it's been discussed for a long time.
Relating to the first question, I have another one. becoming virtual and having the flame body, which is not such an innocent concept of becoming virtual. If you know, in Orthodox spirituality, we talk about of intense period of prayer, during what our body becomes like flame. It is actually reinverse the signification of mystical experience of light into some virtual concept of virtual intelligence. If you understand what I'm saying.
I do, and it's very interesting that you notice this short insert where I alluded to Kelly and you can read a couple sentences. But it strikes me that, you know, when we try, I've dealt with this in a different way, but, you know, I wrote a ton of my work is a meditation on information theory and its consequences. And I have addressed the tendency in some writers, even great ones like John Hawking Moore, no less, who died a few years ago, to make of us an informational pattern and to say that this is the soul and therefore the body, bye-bye. And I can't start making sense of this. I mean, Hawking Moore might have been a great quantum physicist, I respect that, but his insights there are wrong. Because if you look at what I alluded to, the ictic particular experiences, say you take a beautiful verse of a poem you like, it has no information content. It cannot be measured by signal. It's all hidden in the redundancy. And so it seems to me that in reference to the flame, if you pull it toward a spiritual, mystical experience, and it speaks to you precisely, but this has no information content. You would have to live out the same experience and live it in the way A, B, C, D, E have lived it to make sense of it. And so it seems to me that there is a danger. Pierre Lévy has been very much inspired by Michel Sack, and I'm a, if I were to show you right here next to me on the shelf, I'm an avid reader of Michel Sack, read him for decades. But this book, Pousset, which is, I don't remember how he called it in English, but it's been translated. Pousset is, puss is the tongue, right? And so, as you know, the young people around us, I'm sure it's not different in Romania, they're always typing with their thumbs, right? They don't use all the fingers because the screen is so small. And he claims that this young student, be trendy, chooses a female student, and she has the world in her hands by having this phone, right? And I think the metaphor of the flame is a dangerous one, a clever one at the same time, but to claim that you have all the knowledge in your head because you have a CD-ROM or something in your hands with all the words of Plato say, is simply to misjudge what's really going on. So I think that, as David Gelernter said once, a brilliant computer scientist from Yale, who was almost killed by that Unabomber I quoted, Theodore Kuczynski, right? He dropped a package next to his office that was supposedly a doctoral dissertation and was a bomb, right? And he lost a hand and a high and an eye and what have you. But as Gelernter said, and the war going on now, we'll bear this out, we're not fighting for information. We're fighting for raw primary resources. And so there, I think there's a danger of delusion over the immaterialization of the processes that run the world. In the end, it's still very material. The question was excellent, thank you. Reverend.
Could I just make one comment and one question? The comment, I think, is in relation to John Polkinghorne. I myself have actually attacked John Polkinghorne on a number of issues, not least his view of divine action, which I think is tied to a particular sort of personalistic theism. But certainly I've been looking quite recently on his notion of the information bearing pattern. And it's interesting that he sees that as actually having an effect on our understanding of the body and of the resurrection body. He doesn't sort of do away with the body as such. I'm not sure he's coherent in doing so, but he is at least attempting to sort of, I think he regards it as a sort of updating of Aquinas on the soul as the form, you know, the form of the body. So I'll just make that comment. My question is a completely different one, because it's, and it's really to do with what you said about neo-scholasticism and the reaction against neo-scholasticism within your own Roman Catholic Church. I was quite recently reading Hans Mersler's book called Nouvelle Theologie and Sacramental Ontology, I think it's called, or the term Sacramental Ontology, I can't remember the exact title. But it does seem to me that one of the interesting things about French-speaking theology, particularly in the first half of the 20th century with people like Yves Congar, was what they called a ressource of honor, going back particularly to the Greek fathers, and a sort of moving beyond neo-scholasticism, and as I see it, a move greatly towards certain Orthodox understandings, which actually is a move not really understood within the Orthodox Church. Is that a reasonable reading, do you think? Because it does seem to me that, as I say, within the Roman Catholic world, particularly that French-speaking theology, which came really from two groups, one up in Belgium, which happened in Paris, one, I think, down in Lyon, represents a remarkable movement within the Roman Catholic Church, not only in the sense that it strongly affected the Second Vatican Council, but also it represents a move towards a number of Orthodox perspectives, which, as I said, are not understood within the Orthodox Church, even though, in fact, some of the thinking that was happening at the time came about partly because of that French-Russian circle in Paris, in which, yes. Is that a reasonable reading, do you think?
I think it is. I mean, when I taught theology to students at St. Thomas, University of St. Thomas in Minnesota, because I, 10 years about in my career was spent in the U.S., and this was an introductory to theology class, and I thought I would call on to an article of Jean-Denis Loup that, and then I would frame it in the context where you have to remember that people who were raised up in this Catholicism that tended to not make a strong distinction between being Catholic and being of a certain class or descendants or having a name with particles, we say in French, does something, you know. And these people also were told that the world was evil and dangerous and all that you want. And then some intellectuals ended up in of Lager, and, you know, they were detained by the Germans, and then they were against communists or atheists, they were both fighting a common evil. And so the perspective changed, and I think the one who drove it home the best was Daniel, because he said, we now have to recognize that we will not study God as an object, but always as a subject. And I think this is where the Orthodox tradition, as I said, very fond of and very close to, has never gotten ensorcered in this objectivization of God. It's evident from reading the great Cappadocians and the great fathers. And I think that is a key point indeed. But there is, sadly, a resistance to this. It's Nouvelle Théologie was half, you know, accusatory. It was Nouvelle, and that was a problem. And it still is in some circles, I'm afraid. And so, yes, I think your read is one I would validate, and it's quite an interesting one, and I would love to pursue that with you.
Thank you very much. Very interesting debate. I profit of this to pass to the, for the questions for Reverend Knight, but of course, if you have if Professor Garnell could stay for another 10, 15 minutes.
I would stay to hear the questions addressed to Reverend Knight. And I also, another time, I want to thank you for the grace with which you switched over, and it's like seamless and flawless. I'm really sorry this won't happen again.
Thank you very much, and thank you very much for both. So, questions for Reverend Knight or Professor Garnell? Please.
Who's the record?
Who's the record?
Okay. Thank you very much, Mr. Gagnon, for your presentation. It's for you that I have this question. I found very interesting. Can you hear me?
It's not super clear, but I do hear you. Yes.
Okay. I'll come forward. Is it better now?
Yes, it is now.
Okay, thank you. So I found very interesting that you, I took note for one thing that you said, that the image of God in us cannot be destroyed, but the resemblance can be altered. And I think this is a very, very interesting observation in the context of technology and transhumanism, because we can realize, starting from this, that is one stage would be say that by the means of technology we alter environment, nature, or the creation of God. Then the next level will be the resemblance of God. Why? Because it will become more and more difficult for us to understand the biblical message. Why? Because we are losing the reference. In brackets being put, it's more and more difficult for us to understand our biblical passage as the parable of the sower. So the one who goes out with the seed and throwing the seed in the fields. Now, my question is not this leading us towards an understanding of the human being as a sort of a battlefield between God and evil? If so, where is the red, the thin line which is separating us from having a manichaeical or gnostical understanding of this? This would be the question. Thank you.
So it's for me to answer or for Reverend Knight?
Both.
For me? Okay. I can go ahead with something and then let him have the mic. So I think that it's an excellent question. The transhumanist seems to me to want to save or clear up a future at our image. And it's an image we create for ourselves. There are things we value, we deem important. This letter to Max Moore could be an exercise in, you know, logic 101 or rhetoric, you know, because there's all these assumptions I try to pull out of you. But then we would have to note, with Joseph Pieper, the great German Catholic philosopher, that we fail to realize that refusing any gift, any grace, charis in Greek, gift, right? Refusing any gift from God, which would have us undergo a metamorphosis, precisely the term I used. In fact, we acquiesce to less where we had been promised more. And the exact quote from Pieper was interesting. It's from Glück und Contemplation, happiness and contemplation. The Titan's arrogance, which wants nothing as a gift, demands in reality not too much, but too little. This is true, surprising though it may at first seem. And so if I had time to expand, I would recall the most, I think, most important research I've ever made, just for one article on Nietzsche, because I wanted to understand this galaxy, and I kept reading and reading and reading, and it ends up that if you read Nietzsche, I cannot build them as an atheist. All I can do is refer you to my article where I lay out the reasons why, but the fact is that there is this light of Christian hope that I cannot see in a purely secular project. So in other words, what he's a witness of is the dangerousness of kicking God out of the picture. And I think the greatest danger is to settle for less when we can have more. But this would require to understand reason in a different way, as I said earlier. And we had at our chair in Lille a lecture by one of the finest Orthodox thinkers in France, Bertrand de Jolie, recently. And I discussed with him how in his book, Retour à l'émerveillement, he makes a distinction between reason and entendement, reason in a restricted sense. And I think if we don't recover reason in the larger sense, we're off to something not so good.
Reverend Knight, please.
Yes, just, first of all, I agree with that entirely. It seems to me that we have reduced reason or rationality to a certain discursive ability, which clearly is part of what in a way it is to be human. But I've spoken in several of the things that I've written about that sort of patristic distinction, which actually goes back to Greek philosophy, so it's not even specifically Christian, in which the discursive rational faculty, dianoia in Greek, sits side by side with an immediate contemplative intuitive faculty, the nous, and it's only when those two are actually being used together that we actually have reason in that deeper sense, which we just heard about. Yeah, in particular in answer to the question, I would say this, that we do have to recognize that there, as I said, I think in my talk, that there is a tension, biblically, between, you know, the lion seeking its food from God, which for the prey of the lion must be a little bit like the problem of evil, and the eschatological vision where the wolf will lay down with the lion, don't just eat it. So there must be a sense in which what we call the problem of evil has to be dealt with in terms of that tension, that there is a tension between this world as we experience it and the eschatological state as we understand it insofar as we can. Now, part of that, again, we can go back to St. Irenaeus, that John Hick's book, Evil and the God of Love, which came out in the 1960s, very much drew on Irenaeus in terms of that, in terms of the sense of the world, as I think he called it, the veil of soul making. So that what we think of as evil, though it may be, as has just been said, that, you know, for God there is in that sense no evil. What we think of as evil is part of that process. It is part of the second blessing added by God to his original intentions, going back to that notion of the garments of skin, which Peleus Nellas particularly draws from St. Gregory of Nyssa and St. Maximus the Confessor. So, but that doesn't mean, and this is important, attention is not a complete distinction. We're not falling back on the sort of Manichaean thing in which the world is seen as evil. The world is seen as good, but partly because of this second blessing, as Nellas calls it, I think, direct equation, one or other of those two fathers, is part of the goodness of this world as it is from our perspective now as fallen beings. So in that sense, the fall is very important. And as I've said, I think there are ways of thinking about the fall which may sound very untraditional to certain people, but they're actually not in the least untraditional. As I say, though, it was there as a result of sort of origin speculations in the patristic era. There are various modern Orthodox scholars who have tried to deal with that. So it's still, in a sense, a good world, but it's not a goodness which is precisely the goodness of the eschatological state, simply because in this world, as fallen beings, we need a certain kind of world to be good, and that world seems to us to have this problem of evil within it. But it's still ultimately a good world, even if it's not the world as it is in God's, what I sometimes call his original and ultimate intentions. It's a transitional phase, and if you recognize that transitional phase as part of the goodness of God's world, then I think we can avoid any sort of Manichaean, you know, formal distinction between God on the one hand who is good and the world on the other hand that is evil. And certainly from an Orthodox perspective, I think it's very important that we do avoid that sort of evil. It's, you know, it's the distinction that you get, for instance, in the spiritual life between asceticism, which is a training of a sort, and puritanism, which actually feels that there is something actually wrong with the good things in the world, and they're to be avoided because they're actually rather nasty. That's, again, an important distinction. in the Orthodox spiritual path, we stress asceticism, but not because what we're sometimes avoiding, let's say during the fasting seasons or whatever, is somehow bad. It's simply because it's a training which is part of that. It's part of that bringing back the likeness of God. If the image hasn't been destroyed, we recognize that the likeness has been at least distorted, and that asceticism is part of the process by which that likeness is ultimately regained.
Thank you very much. We have another question.
Hello, first of all, thank you for the very interesting both presentations. I'm a computer scientist and professor of artificial intelligence, but a critic of artificial intelligence, and also a Christian Orthodox believer and practicant. I have a question mainly for Professor Gagnon, but also if your opinion, Reverend Christopher, would be interesting. So in artificial intelligence, for many years, was a paradigm of symbolic artificial intelligence. In recent years, deep neural networks are state of the art, and there are some amazing achievements. But my question is there a change in these new facilities? In fact, intuition, you discussed about intuition, and we know intuition, creativity, understanding, consciousness even, are not yet achieved by artificial intelligence. And my opinion is that probably never will be totally achieved. But what about intuition and creativity? Some may say that having a huge neural network like GPT-3, which is state of the art, and has all the books on the which are on the world, Wikipedia and so on, could such a neural network achieve intuition or creativity? What is your opinion? Thank you.
Well, if it's about my opinion, I think that we credit way too much to machines, and when they do performance, we have to be very careful to see how it was inserted in them and how it's just an answer to what a question we ask, and we don't get a larger answer. But the thing that I wanted to do, maybe stress, and time was not very long, so as I said, it would have to remain quite introductory, but. The triumphalistic AI, which transfers to the fact of human cognition softwares that it would have conceived, might be seen as giving back to man something that is the flip side, so to speak, of what it took from him. In other words, that its calculating deductive regime that used to be happening in some kind of outside, outward realm. And even if you look at the foundation of modern logic in Frege, there's this revival of a sort of, lecton or semi-numenon or objective place where a meaning would be inscribed. And so we would therefore expect of man procedures of description that he ought to follow when he executes this or that task. And so, like I said earlier, there might be another paradox to be found here when we find in cognitive science, and in a clandestine or almost implicit way, there's this negative objectivation of what is human. In other words, we determine a priori man's intelligence as that which we know not how to simulate by means of a program. And so I think that in your experience, I'm sure you would be able to find examples of this, so that the computationalist objectivization of the work of the mind, which is done a priori, right, would work alongside a silent negation of this very program. And so I think the two would work hand in hand. We've had these construal of the reasoning process that have very little to do with reality. How one of the great Chinese logicians said at one point, we have to wonder whether this symbolic or mathematization of logic will lead us anywhere, because it doesn't have anything to do with ordinary language. And as a matter of fact, the the more we mathematicize and noticize language, the more fragile it is and the less relevant it is to express anything. And so on the one hand, we have these models that were somehow inspired by, like I said, very old and deep conception of rationality, but at the same time, alongside it, we realize that to think, as phenomenologists that already pointed out, that Bonti and others, to think is to use my feet as much as my brain. And there are cases of people who are found to have almost no brain and have done superior work at MIT. And you know, so I think that there is a transferring of dreams or visions of power here again that has misled us.
Thank you very much, Reverend Knight.
I simply add to that, I think, which I agree with, that one of the problems of talking about intuition or something which is not straightforwardly algorithmic is that we take it to, as a single sort of quality. I think one of the great problems of talking about intuition is that, at least in my view, there are two sorts of intuition which are really quite different. One is what Einstein said about common sense, that it's the layer of prejudices laid down, I think it was Einstein, the layer of prejudices laid down prior to the age of 21. In other words, we do work intuitively in a way which is often quite distorted because it does relate to all sorts of conditioning. The other sort of intuition, which I think is the theological one to focus on here, is what the fathers of the church or in Greek philosophy often talks about in terms of noetic awareness. Now, noetic awareness, it seems to me, is something which is different. And this is one of the problems when we talk about intuition, and why we have to be very careful when people say, you know, I feel in my heart that this is so, because we have to make that distinction. Is that feeling in their heart something which is true noetic awareness, which in the Christian view will only come at the end of a process of spiritual progress, you know, which involves all sorts of things in relation to belief, practice, and so on. So, as I say, I don't have enough insight into artificial intelligence to be able to apply it directly to that. I was, many years ago, quite strongly affected by the mathematician Roger Penrose's book, The Emperor's New Mind, in which he argued that artificial intelligence could never have certain qualities which the human mind have. But and although I've got a background in astrophysics, as I say, my insights into artificial intelligence was not to apply it directly. But I would simply caution that when we talk about intuition, we're talking about something which has two dimensions, if you like, and that true noetic awareness, which we believe comes as part of that contemplative process to which Christians are called, is actually quite different from what Einstein calls that layer of prejudices.
Thank you very much. So we have the last question from online. Professor Ravel Bernardo.
Thank you very much, Professor Florin Roman. And first of all, let me say good morning to all the old participants, and thanks for these special moments spent yesterday together. I'm really sorry that I couldn't be there together with you. But I have only one question for Father Christopher, for Reverend Christopher Knight. I have listened to the dialogues, and I have just found out, and I really knew before, that the human being can be identified as a machine and at the same time as a cyborg. And I would be really interested in knowing your opinion, Father Christopher. What do you suppose, which can be the limit, and if you are ready to identify the limit of the spiritual progress life for such a human being which is ready to change the perspective of the eternity through the technology? Thank you very much.
One of the points of my talk, of course, was that we really do have to look at everything on a case-by-case basis. I don't think that, you know, an artificial heart implant is going to affect anybody's spiritual progress. That's one end of the spectrum. There must come a point at which the sense of embodiment, which which I think is equally important for, you know, for that spiritual progress, there must come a point at which that is being, at the very least, compromised, if not destroyed. And that needs a lot of further thought, I think, as to what degree. And as I say, our traditional or our instinctive ways of making distinctions between what is purely therapeutic at a physical level, which we assume the heart implant is, and what actually affects our cognition. That's not always easy to sort of say in a straightforward way, here are the criteria. What I would say is, as I indicated in the paper, that the whole notion of embodied cognition, as it's being developed in certain parts of the scientific world, does seem to be important, that what we cannot do is simply regard ourselves as a discursive thinking machine, so to speak, where it's software and it doesn't matter what the hardware is. That's actually very important. Being embodied is very important. So I think, you know, the comment that was just made, that we just, you know, we think as much with our foot as we do with our brain, has an important element of truth. On the other hand, if I happen to lose my foot in an accident tomorrow, I don't think that has an ultimate effect on the way in which I exist as a spiritual being. So this is why I say I think we've really got to look at things on a case-by-case basis. When something is proposed or when something happens simply because of the way that technological development has progressed, we have to ask that question. But being embodied, having all those, if you like, embodied instinctive elements is immensely important. And this is why, as I said earlier, I think we've got to recognize the unconscious in various ways, that we are not just discursive thinking machines. There is an unconscious element which is very strongly tied to us being embodied. And there must come a point, as I say, at which that instinctive element, that unconscious element, which is beginning to be recognized by scientists, they now recognize what we called cognitive unconscious. So that at one time, for instance, the behaviorists didn't allow anything in relation to unconscious processes. That has now changed in the scientific world. But we do need to have this recognition that, you know, there is something that lies behind so much of our conscious discursive thinking, which if it's unduly compromised, will actually prevent us from being fully human and thus fully able to enter into this contemplative journey. So that would be my, it may not seem a straightforward answer in the sense that I can't lay down a series of criteria for when things have gone wrong, but that's precisely where we are at the moment, I think. I think we really do need to think through those issues much more than we have in the past. And what we can't do is what the more extreme transhumanists do, which is to ignore that question. And what we equally can't do is what I'm afraid some in the Orthodox world do, is to lump everything that's transhumanist together into one pot and say this is theologically unacceptable. We really do have to look at things on a case-by-case basis and use the best theology, which we don't always do, and the best science, which we certainly don't always do. One of my friends in the United States who is in the science religion world also said one of the great problems about the Orthodox world is that not only individuals, but even individual churches or official bodies sometimes make statements on things which are affected by science, and they simply get the science wrong. That, I think, is very important. So this is why, for me at least, the science-theology dialogue, which I don't like the way it's developed in the West, is one of the reasons I actually wrote that particular book, and in fact I've got another short book coming out from the Cambridge University Elements series in the next week or two, I think, which is called Eastern Orthodoxy and the Science Theology Dialogue, because I have lots and lots of criticisms of the way that has developed over the last 50 years or so. But nevertheless, I think the Science Theology Dialogue, even when it gets things wrong, at least takes science truly seriously. And part of my call to the Orthodox, you know, my fellow Orthodox, is to say, please do take science seriously, because it does inform our theology in a way that's important.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Reverend Knight and Professor Gagnon. It was a very good beginning of the day. Listen to your presentations and answers. For a theological perspective of humanity, singularity, or kingdom oriented, for Professor Yannick Imbert, we have the paper. Unfortunately, he has a problem of scheduling time and couldn't join us. But we have the paper and you could see it. After a short break of around 10 minutes, we'll continue with the last two papers of the day in Romanian, one online and one on here. Thank you very much again.
I will look forward to that. Pleasure. Thanks.
Thank you.